So this is the topic for today, operator interface in automation, PLC visualization. Till yesterday, we were just aware of PLC as a box which has certain interface terminals. You will be connecting your input and output devices to PLC. That's the one part. Visualization, little bit we have already discussed. We want, as a human being, we want more interaction with the system. We want to have more information about the system. So in that case, if you, as I have given you example that if you recall the DOS interface, and if you now compare with the Windows 8.1 or 10, now it is available. You can yourself experience the difference it makes to a user. As a user, that is basically the interface available to you for your laptop or a PC. Fine. If both systems, if I compare in terms of hardware, remains almost same. Both computers were having microprocessors, RAM, ROM, hard disk, everything was there. Keyboard, even display is also there. But the user interface, if you compare with respect to DOS and the Windows 8.1, you can experience what the difference is in terms of a user. Fine. The same thing holds true with the PLCs also, or I should say a broader term for automated systems. Fine. If I just close my eyes and then still my brain is working, like I cannot see anything what is happening inside it. Fine. But same thing happens with the PLC. PLC keep working internally, but you cannot see what is happening. So that's a reason that we need to have some kind of a visualization of activities going on, and so some kind of an information exchange with the system, with all automated systems. Fine. So that's the most important part. So today I will be discussing briefly about the type of visualization possible and available options, and later then I will explain in half an hour how this can be done, how this has to be implemented. Fine. So once I cover the basics, then I will come down to those slides. So let me start with what is an interface. So if I talk about a car, I'm sure all of you have driven this car or this type of car. So I need to know what user interface you have on an automobile or a vehicle. Dashboard. So there are many meters on the dashboard. Fine. So odometer is there, speedometer is there, fuel gauge is there, battery indicator is there. So many gauges are on the dashboard. What other user interface you have?
Steering.
What else? Brakes. Mirrors. What else?
Gears.
Entry into the vehicle. Is that a user interface? Music system. What else?
AC.
Controls, not AC. AC controls, basically the panel that you have to interface with the air conditioner. So we all understand the importance of user interface. Fine. So let me just come down to this. So most of you have already covered this. Interface might be a steering wheel, accelerator pedal, brake pedal, gear stick, rear view mirror, infotainment systems, and so forth. So some interfaces such as dashboard contains visual components like odometer, speedometer, or a radio, or a stereo, or whatever. Nowadays you have a TVs also inside the cars and vehicles. So this is what we understand about a vehicle. Similarly, let's come down to familiar interfaces that you might have seen earlier. Stock ticker, in front of stock exchange you might be seeing this kind of a running text. This is a user interface. Fine. So it's, they just want to update, communicate the updated information about the stock prices live to the user. Fine. So one form of interface. I'm just giving you a glimpse of what kind of interface. So running text or text in a different color will be one form of interface. ATM machines, you might have already seen, there are push buttons on ATM machines, touch screens on the ATM machines, and then you have a display. Fine. So then through that you will be interacting with the system which is delivering cash to you. Then all household appliances such as microwave, oven, you have all keypads around, then you have seven segment displays on the oven. So through that you can see how much time left, you can set up the time, temperature and other parameters. So you have a keypad and then you have a display there. Same way you can have a road signs, overhead information science or road science on the roadways. So there you can see some of that information displayed. It may not be in this form. Sometimes you have a static displays also. They are also a user interface, but then you cannot change the information over there. Fine. So if you just come to the operator interface in automation, what we need to be able to access the state of the process. So you have certain variables, you want to monitor them, and then you want to have some kind of a logging, or you can visualize them. Right? Then this is one. Second, you want at some point of time to control or modify those parameters. Right? So one is the monitoring part, another you want to modify them also. Do you want to change those control parameters? So that is also there. Third, you want to intervene in the process. So you want to stop the process, you want to modify the route of the process, or whatever you want to make changes. So you want some kind of a human intervention in the process. Then you will provide a user interface there. Right? So different kind of devices, if you see. I'm little bit more specific about Rockwell automation because we have those kind of hardware in the lab. So that's why you may find some of the pictures related, or the concept that I'm going to explain. But similar things can be applicable to any other PLC implementation also. So here you can see the different types of operator interface in automation. So some of them you can see on these stands as well. So some of the operator interface, if you can see here. So different type of push buttons you can see, keypads are there, and then small LCDs are there. So earlier there are alphanumeric LCDs, you have those kind of LCDs also. You have a tower light there, so three different indicators on the tower light, so that is also a kind of an user interface. And nowadays you will be having a full-fledged computer screen as a user interface, so you will be able to visualize those parameters. At the same time, you will be able to take some action also by pressing, by touching some portion of that screen based on the buttons that has been made there. So then there are different options. I'm not saying this is good, this is best, no comparison among themselves. Depending on your requirement, whatever you want to give to the user, you have to make a right selection among these operator interfaces. Sometimes even three buttons are good enough. If I'm operating a gantry, I don't want to have a nice LCD screen with the operator. No, it's not required. Even three buttons can help me a lot. Fine. So you are, as a designer, you will be permitting a user to whatever extent you want to interact with the system. Sometimes more interference will create a crash down of the system. So that is also, you should be careful. You will not be giving full control to the operator. So you will be little bit selective in giving some interface to the user, some control you want with the system itself. Fine. So human machine interface. So that is basically we call a common term HMI. So human machine interface provides the means to visualize a process. Now the last two terms, locally or remotely. So one user interface you will find immediately on the system. So wherever the operator is working, he can directly manipulate those parameters. So or he can directly visualize those parameters on the system. So that is basically the local HMI. Sometimes I want to monitor centrally. As an example I was giving I think yesterday, when you want to monitor 1 lakh towers sitting in a room, what is happening at every location. So that's basically remote monitoring of the system. Right? So that both way it can be possible. So user interface will be either local or it will be a remote. Fine. So let's discuss about this. There are two types of HMI functionalities. One is basically for monitoring. Another is for control. Fine. So monitoring means you will be able to see the parameters only. So control and display. There are two things basically that you want to have on the user interface. You want user to just monitor some of the parameters, so that you need some kind of a display. Fine. And then if you want to give some kind of a control, then you have to include some of the control input options in the user interface. Fine. So sometimes it's suppose if I will give you an example of a stock ticker. There's no input required from the user. It's just a display of information and it keep changing. Right? So you don't need any user input there. But sometimes you want to give flexibility to the user to, after visualizing those parameters, he can manipulate those parameters. Right? So then we have advanced systems which include both control and display together in the single unit. So you have visualization there. At the same time, you have an option to change parameters and interact with the system. So I think all these two HMIs are basically of that type only. They are touch screen based, so you can directly interact with the HMI also. It's not just for visualization. You can even control the system based on that. So you can make certain selections from there, and then you can control the system. Right? Let me give a quick example of visualization in an automated control system. So suppose this is a complete plant. So there are three different locations where we have these visualization interfaces available. One is basically at the input level. So if you see here, this is a operator interface where operator will start the line from a keypad or touch screen button. So some interface available with the operator directly, from where he will be able to start the production line. Right? Second interface is basically at the logic control level. So there you can have a system which will make decisions and generate alarms. So it keep on monitoring the process, and then it will generate the alarms, different type of alarms. Right? So that's basically a logic system inside this. And then at remote location in a plant somewhere, you can have you have options to monitor and log the information. So output of the whole plant will then get dumped. So that the people can monitor the line status, what is happening, how much is the production rate, where is the inventory, and how much is the backlog, or whatever parameters they want to monitor about the system. So now you have an operator interface for the input, immediate input. Then you have a logic control interface. There you will see the different type of alarms and the other logical information will get displayed. And then you have another location where people would like to monitor the status of the complete plant. Fine. So that's a three locations normally you'll find the visualization requirement in the automated control system. So depending on the functionality, as I mentioned, that you have a lot of options nowadays available for implementing visualization. So again, this is very important. Again, I keep on emphasizing that as a system, if you want to implement an automated system, it's very important to have some kind of a user interface. Otherwise, you will be just making the operator blind. He will not be able to see anything what you have done. Sometimes it's very important for debugging also. If the process is running, you want to monitor certain parameters whether they are changing correctly or not. Whatever program you have written in the PLC, whether it is executing correctly or not. So that will help basically the designer to debug the system. Fine. So then different kind of user interfaces available for different functionalities. Even you can log the data, you can generate the alarms, you can even plot the trends. Suppose if I have interface where I want to monitor the change in temperature inside the furnace, so you can monitor the trend of that variation of the temperature also. So all those parameters you can capture and then log and display. Fine. So both options are possible there. So one sort of is visual or audible signal. So you will have visual indicator in the shop floor at a different locations. Sometimes they are just displaying the how much parts has been produced till now. I remember when I was at Tata Motors, there is a big board at the entrance that showing how much vehicle has been produced yesterday and how many vehicle has to be made today. So the people get idea in 180 trucks per day they have to make. So that way they keep on changing. So at the entrance itself, they want the user or the operator which is entering into the plant to know the number for today. Fine. So some kind of a display. Same thing in the different location in the plant also. They keep on displaying certain critical parameters. And so everybody around they can see it. But sometimes visual information is not complete information. Whenever you want to create an immediate alert, you need an audible alert. Visual information, whenever you just look at it, then only you come to know about that. But audible alert will immediately take your attention there. Fine. So sometimes you want audible signals also. Suppose if there's an emergency push button, if someone press this emergency push button, there should be an audible alert as well. So visual indicator is fine. You can blink that red indicator, but I want to sound a siren also. Fine. So some kind of alert can be. So visual or audible signals can be used for communicating the information. Then, as I mentioned, then you can have an advanced features also where you can plot the trend of the variables. So in PLC, whenever you write a program, you will be capturing information from different sensors. So at the same time, one is that PLC is taking decision using that information. That is one thing. Second thing, I want to check whether PLC has done the right job or not, whether the program, whatever written, is correctly working or not. So I can log the data, and then later I can see the variation of that data over a period of time. So you have all those options available over here. So you can just design this kind of a system. We'll come later on how this can be done. And then at the back end, you keep on logging that information. For a running plant, this kind of information is very important. Now, let me discuss more specific thing. So there are two different type of HMI. So once I have explained you, there are different interfaces required at different location in the plant. So one HMI is basically machine level HMI, so which you found directly under the machine. So these are all machine HMI. If you can see here on this system, these are the machine HMI, where you have to give an access to your operator immediately near the machine. Fine. So small applications, device designed to perform role of an operator interface directly under the machine, dedicated piece of hardware working and connected with that machine to give the information. So this is basically a machine level operator interface. So there are certain limitations with the hardware. It's not nothing wrong about this. So we don't need much functionality at the operator interface level. So this has certain limitations. I just put down some limitations. So number of screens, whenever I say, so these are all related to the user interface, how you design user interface. When I say 30 screens approximately, screens means how many pages you can make on this interface. So then the software will make those pages available to you. So one screen, the main welcome screen, then you touch another button, there's another screen coming up, and then so on and so forth. The same way you can see here, there are buttons there, five buttons. You press individual button, then you will get five different screens. Then individual screens you will be interacting further. So you have certain constraint on those number of screens that you can make in HMI. The kind human machine interface. And then there is a constraint on the number of parameters it can monitor to generate the alarms. So around 50 alarm messages you can have. And again, I'm not very particular about these numbers. I'm just trying to give you a feel about the machine level HMI constraints. And so these numbers keep on changing and the system keep on evolving. Right? So these are some numbers captured 5 years back or so. And then how many data elements you can log, so how many data variables you can log in this device. So that's again a constraint in terms of memory. Earlier these HMIs are based on Windows CE platform actually. So slowly now they keep on moving into Windows XP embedded or some other system is coming in. So as the system's functionality in terms of hardware as well as the software as well as the storage capacity keep on increasing, these variables keep on changing. Right? So but the main thing is how many variables you can log, that is important. So whenever we design SCADA or whenever we design a system for operator interface, these are the some of the parameters we should keep in mind. In other ways, basically these commercial people who are making these softwares, they are putting constraint like this. So that is another way they are restricting a user to develop so many screens on this kind of a system. Then second comes basically that we will discuss slowly. It's a supervisory level HMI and that we call as SCADA. So it's a very big buzzword in the industry. Whenever you say you know SCADA, they immediately get a signal that yeah, you know very much about the automation. So we'll discuss today what exactly is the SCADA and how it can be implemented. Right? So we will do a small implementation about the SCADA also today. So yeah, I will come to the next slides. Yeah, we'll discuss. I'm not disclosing a word right now. We'll have a slide, we'll discuss on that. So when we say supervisory level HMI, now it's not operator level interface only. We want to supervise the complete system. Fine. So now we need to monitor those variables and parameters remotely. Fine. So supervisory level may or may not have this kind of interface. It may have, but we need to have a more advanced systems in terms of servers and then different clients distributed over different region. Fine, that's basically the bigger picture of this small HMI. So if we have multiple HMIs distributed over at a different geographical locations and then we are having a central server, so we'll come onto all these technologies, then it's basically a bigger network of this smaller HMIs. Fine, so that is what, and that is basically not just limited to the operator. Then supervisor, plant manager, GM or whatever, a chairman, whoever wants to see what is happening inside the plant, they can use that system. Otherwise, what will happen in this HMI, the person has to come here and then see what is happening in this particular stand. I cannot see from my office what is happening in this stand 1 and stand 2. Fine. So that kind of flexibility will be given to the people who operate the plant. Fine. So it has much more capabilities, because now we will be using a full-fledged systems in the form of computers and servers. So then the constraint is not there. You can have as many as screens nowadays, because that flexibility is there, but that number is again limited by the license they are giving into. So, but you can have 100 plus screens, 500 plus alarm messages, 1000 plus data log elements, and customization options. So now because it's a complete Windows computer or Linux computer, it's open to you, the hardware and software, no constraint as such. Whatever application you want to build as a user interface, you can do on that. Fine. And then whenever we have this kind of a supervisory level HMI, we call it basically the SCADA. That is supervisory control and data acquisition. Now the two terms that you can see clearly here, supervisory control and data logging, data acquisition. So data acquiring continuously from different systems at one location, and then based on that data, the supervisor can also take a decision or take an action. Fine. So here we are just limiting it to the operator. Fine. So that's the common term for the SCADA. We'll discuss how this has been done and how this can be implemented today. So supervisory level HMI. Before coming to this, let me just understand from your perspective, what do you mean by server? If I say server, what exactly it means? Because I was having a very wrong definition, or I should say perception about a server 5-10 years back. So I just want to know from your, if I say server, can I have this machine as a server? That's what I, my question is, can I have this laptop as a server?
Yes.
All of you agreed that yes? Can I have your mobile as a server?
Yes.
So now hardware is not the thing that we can distinguish a server and a client. Fine. So that's the first thing, because I was also having that impression earlier that a big computer is known as server. These machines are not server. So how many of you have that kind of impression? So we always have that kind of a perception that server means a much bigger system which can serve to many clients or many people, they can use it. So that is server. No, it's not like that. Server is basically a system which is serving some information, whoever is asking that. So I can have this laptop as a server. I can run an application. I can develop an application on this system which will keep communicating with my hardware every time. It's continuously updating itself with the hardware. And then whoever requests this information, the system can serve that information. So then client can be anything. We'll discuss those clients also. So a server is a machine which will keep interacting with the hardware. It will keep getting data from the system. And then it also has a provision to serve that information to the client, whichever client it is. So that system, so that kind of a program that resides in the computer, we call it as a server. Same, we can have a client application. Fine. So client can be anything. I am showing over here a simple PC that can act as a client. So then client can request a data and then display. So now display is coming on the client. It's not on the server. Server is communicating with the system, getting the data, collecting all informations. And then whenever you request that information, that get displayed on your local system. And then we call it a client. So client is then making a request. So again, it's an application or a software that resides on your hardware. It will make a request to the server and then get that information and then display it. Simple example is a web server and a web client. Very, very simple example. All of us are familiar with using internet. So there is a server sitting somewhere, Google server or IIT server somewhere. You have all sort of data there. Whenever we want to request that information, so we have a browser as a client. So browser is just a simple client. All information is not with this system. All information resides with the server. But when browser send a request, whatever you give as an input, it will make a request to the server, get that information flowing on the network, and then display. So images are finally moving inside the network as a binary data. But then visualization of that image will be the part of a client. Fine. So that's how the simple client server system works. Same thing works in the SCADA also. Right? So I will just, so you can have a server, a client, but then different configurations are there. I will just show you.
The number of the clients are more.
I'm coming to that. Just wait, two, three slides, I will be. One first is the standalone system. So again, it's a complete SCADA, but standalone system, I can have a server and a client in a single system. I can have. So my laptop is communicating if I put a Ethernet cable and connect with that system. So then it's acting as a server, getting a data from a PLC. At the same time, I can build a front interface, user interface, through which I can visualize that information. So I can have a system which is a standalone system. It can be a single PC that can act as a server as well as client, both. Both functionalities combined together. So you will be running two different applications, server application, which will be collecting information from the hardware, and then front end you will be developing and then displaying that information on a client. So client would be a different application I can open in the system, and then there is a server application which is running in the back end. Right? So you can have both the application running together simultaneously on a single system. So I can develop a complete SCADA in a single PC. That's fine. That's a standalone system. But then we can have a different configuration also, so distributed system. So sometimes you have a different locations, you want to capture that information at a different locations locally, and then you want to share it with different people. Fine. So then I can have multiple servers in the system and multiple clients in the system. Fine. So that's another configuration. Fine. So you can have multiple computers, and then some are server, some are acting as a client. Then we can have different architecture in which it can work. So once I understood, I can have a server, but minimal, I should have one server, one client, and there's a minimal requirement. But then scalability I can do based on the requirement, whether you want more clients to access the server, or whether you want more servers to gather information, and one client I want to access all information together. Fine. So there are different architecture there. So I can have one server, multiple client. Fine. So one server gathering all information from the system, then I can have many people accessing that information. Fine. So this is a simple, very good example of a web server. So web server, we have one server, there are many clients accessing that website and information. Fine. Then you can have many servers in the plant gathering information, and then we can have a one client window over here. I just want to observe and monitor what is happening inside the plant. So information collected locally at a different servers. So based on the magnitude of the system that you want to implement. So if it's a small system, we can make a appropriate selection on that. But we can have this kind of a configuration also, multiple server, one client, or one server, multiple client. And that's all possible. You can have, pardon?
Multiple servers and single client.
Multiple server, single client. I can have an application. I depute multiple servers. Suppose if I give you an example of each department in this institute. I put one server in mechanical department, one server in electrical, computer science, and so forth. And then I will develop an application. As a director, I can see and access the server of any department which I want. Right? So that's an individual department keep updating their own server. If I put one server, then it's a different thing. Or I can give an example, like if I have multiple institute all over India, and then I want to store that information locally, gather that information locally, and then made it accessible to a central location. So that is basically the...
At a time, only one information of one particular server can be seen by the client?
Definitely. Definitely. You cannot access Microsoft Word and PowerPoint at the same time. You cannot. At one time, you can see only one window. So that user interface you have to design. What I am saying, then client application you will be designing in a fashion that you will, that same client application, one red indicator is coming from one plant, another red indicator from another plant, but I can have all red indicators on the same user interface, and that's a way.
You can have picture in picture also, sir. We can have, say, and picture in picture.
Correct.
And take two different.
Correct. You can, so that's all up to you how you want to develop an application. So client application, how you will be combining the information from various sources to put in a single interface. Right? Suppose if I want to see, as I mentioned, that 1 lakh towers in a single screen. So information is coming from different sources. But then I can design my user interface in such a way that I can select anyone and then see it. Fine. So the immediate status you can have, then you click it individually, then you can go into the details, whatever you want to say. So it's all about designing of a client application, right? So as a part of a user interface. Then you can have a server client and server client communicating among themselves. So it's a, so all sort of interfaces are possible. Let me give a very complete example of a client types and the servers over here. So it's a complete architecture if I show you here. So we have different servers. Why do we need multiple servers? I'm sure those who have little access to the information about computer science and other. Why my institute have a different web server, mail server, file server, and so on and so forth? Why not a single machine can do the job? Any answer from your end? I am a mechanical guy, I don't understand computing, but you should tell me why we should have a different servers. Print server is also there, yeah. So why we need to have different machines for different functionalities?
High speed and more security.
Correct, more security, and then load, how much load it can take. If I have 1,000 users on the campus, I am running a web server which will be giving access to all users outside this campus, maybe lakh user accessing IIT Delhi website. So that all communication is coming to single machine. At the same time, I want local people also access their own files frequently. Then some are giving the printing commands, some, and then mails are continuously coming. Yeah, daily you will see, if you just check mail after half an hour, 15-20 mails are there. For individual user, for multiple users, you see how much load is there. So the capability of a machine is limited, fine? Otherwise I could have us all servers together in a single machine. So it's better to organize, and then the functionality of that system is different little bit. So web server is working differently, your print server is working differently. So it's better to distribute. So that's why that is distributed system. Distribute the load. If one person wants to do all jobs, he cannot do efficiently. So we can have multiple servers for different tasks. And that's the reason that we should have. So we have here display server. If you see here, I will show you the architecture. I have a display server here. Then I have another server which is running a terminal service or a display client. So you can have server which will basically provide the information which you want to display on the client. Fine. So we have two servers over here. Then we have a display client over here. So there are five people sitting in the same room. They want to access the information in this server. So they are wired, connected by wire. The physical Ethernet is there, or LAN connection is there, or whatever you want to have. Normally Ethernet. Then all that information can be locally accessible by these display clients. These are computers with the different people. Very good example as a bank. If you just correlate, forget about the automation. A bank works like this only. So you have a bank server. The client are all cashiers sitting around, managers sitting around. They can have access to the system. Someone is creating an account, someone is just making an entry for the cash withdrawal or whatever. So they are accessing different application running on the web server, but they have a different display client over here. Fine. Then there are terminal services. Terminal services means through command prompt you are interacting with the system. So many times you don't need to have a graphical interface. You can have a terminal interface through which you can communicate with the system. And then local web-based client. So you have a web browser. That through the display client and web-based client, there's a little bit difference. So display client, I should say, some kind of a thin clients. I don't know whether you have heard about that or not. It's a simple PC, not having much power to process the information, but it can run one application. So every time you want to put a system in a security, you don't want people to keep browsing while making a cache entries. No. So then I will limit the person to just one screen. He can just log in and make entries there only. I don't want access to other locations in the system. That is basically thin client. So dedicated application made on for that display. So that is basically the display client. When I say web client, it means then I have access to that same information but through a browser. So that is basically the web. So these all are connected locally on a network that you can see through red lines. Then we have a CE-based clients. Windows CE-based clients means basically the machine HMI. So I can have this kind of an interface also on the same network. But then you see all these are local. I'm still saying these are all connected on a local network. Fine. Then if you see, there is a PLC also on the same network. Fine. So they are accessing now information from PLC. So clients are not directly having access to the PLC. It's not allowing the client to directly manipulate the PLC variables. The request will go to the server. and then server will handle the PLC. Fine, so that's a way they should work. Then now if you see after that, this is a local network. Now no more this information wants to remain in local environment. We want to access this information anywhere now. So in that case, you see, I need to have some kind of a communication interface that extend the boundaries beyond this room or beyond the location where these all servers has been kept and all these clients are working. So then I should need some kind of a wireless communication. All ATMs have this kind of a connectivity. If you see that, all ATMs have a VSAT terminal communicating to the bank server through a wireless communication, dedicated wireless communication. So I can extend the geographical location of this system through a wireless communication. So I need to put a wireless transceiver unit. It can be a VSAT, it can be a 3G, or it can be anything, whatever you think on. And then you can have a internet also. This is basically the dedicated link that you can have. You can use internet also. So once you have a system accessible for outer world through a public IP system, then you can access all that information through a remote system also. Fine. So those kind of terminals are also, they can be anywhere. Then you will be accessing the same information but through a internet and through a dedicated. So the communication, once you put a communication in between, then you are extending the geographical regions basically. You can have mobile clients also. So wireless clients, they may be accessing either through internet, or you can have a dedicated handheld which will be directly communicating with the system. So all sort of options are possible. So the point I want to make over here, once you gather the information, once your hardware is communicating and then getting the information exchange with the server, then you can access that information anywhere, wherever you want, through whatever type of device you want. So that's a beauty. So now I'm extending the concept beyond a single room or single lab to a worldwide geographical location. Fine. So many applications nowadays got developed on mobile phones. The person going to collect a bill, he can just take a meter reading there itself, generate the bills there. He's giving all sort of services. I'm sure you might have taken deliveries from FedEx and Blue Dart. He get an immediately sign there. You get a SMS. It has been delivered. So earlier, what you used to do, they will just make all the deliveries, go to the system, enter all details, and then whenever you want to check the information, you can see whether this consignment delivered, then you can do that through web access. But nowadays, the system has been made more advanced. You have a immediate in. By the time you take the consignment, reach your room, you will get a SMS. It has been delivered. So this kind of a services, this kind of information is very important in terms of in automated system as well. So I've just explained with a very simple example, and there are a lot of clients I have just mentioned how this all system connected together. And any query till here? I think I will just skip this basic info because this I have already explained. Yeah. So this is what the SCADA. I have just give you an overview of what exactly it means. So acronym I have already mentioned, as he has asked, supervisory control and data acquisition. So it allow you to monitor and control now various remote functions and processes using communication. So this is most important part that is coming in between master and remote locations. And so this is, once we integrate this communication between the master and remote, then it's basically a SCADA implementation that I have done. Right? Though in a single machine, if I am implementing in a server a client, that is also a SCADA. Right? And communicating with the hardware. Through anything. I'm just leaving that up to you. Communication, I'm just leaving. It's open. You can have a fiber optics, you can have a wired Ethernet, or you can have a wireless communication, point-to-point wireless devices, you can have a satellite communication, you can have a 3G communication, whatever. Only thing is that we need a connectivity between a system sitting over here to the outside world. And so that is required. Just quickly, I would like to show you this picture which give you a complete overview over here. Now, if you see, there's a master station over here. There's a master station. I have all sort of PLCs. So now, one system that I have shown in the previous slide, I can put that system over here. So I have Rockwell Automation system only. You can have any other PLC also. I'm not just limiting that, but this slide is basically particular about that. So we have a control logics PLC, suppose if I give you. So PLC is supposed to serve some functions at the master station, right? And then you have certain servers over here, and then you can have certain clients, and then there's an Ethernet backbone locally. So this is basically a master station, so one cluster over here. In the same master station, so the first dotted line, if you can see here, it's a one master station. You can have another type of PLCs also, again connected on an Ethernet, and you can have multiple clients, right? You can have some clients only at the master station, that is also possible. So it means basically a combination of different hardware. You can, so you will be having a server, you will be having some kind of a clients, display clients there, and then you will be having a PLC hardware. So this is something local, this is something local. Now at the same time, this master station want to monitor some of the parameters of the remote stations as well. Fine. So if you see here now, I will show some of the remote stations. So one remote station is here, where I can place one PLC again. So Micrologix 1500, if I show you over here, and then it will be again interfaced with the system there, maybe a pump or maybe some sensors or the level sensors, whatever you want to have. So you will be having a complete system over here with a PLC with a different inputs and outputs connected there, right? Then at a different location for some other functionality, I have a different PLC, and then I want to have a user interface also. So you will see here, there's a user interface placed over here, and it will be connecting different information at this location. Then another remote location, so like that. So you can have such remote stations now. So one master station I have, and then I can have multiple remote stations at different locations. So this is fine, they are independently capable of working in their own context. So everything is working fine. Remote station individually, because we already put a PLC over there. So PLC is capable of executing the complete program, taking care of all the variables in the same location, fine. Same way, the another remote station is self-sustained. It can do all those automated calculations or decision making at that its own location. But then once we have such multiple systems, centrally we also want to monitor them. So one example is a water pumping system in the city or any location. Second would be the good example of the power distribution. So all these are basically a very good example of SCADA, fine. So in this case, we are capturing the, so we have a self-sustained automated system at one location. But then I want to have, so if I just left those locations, then I may not be knowing who is making the power station on at 6 a.m., who is not making at 6 a.m., 6:30 a.m., what is happening at all locations. As a central authority, I cannot have that kind of information. So I want that to get connected. At the same time, if someone fails at a one location, if the person didn't turn up to make the power station on or the substation on, I should have an option to access it and then make it on from the master station. So that kind of control also, you can have that kind of control. Monitoring is fine, monitoring you can do that, but sometimes you need a control. That is why it's known as SCADA, supervisory control over the local stations. You have now a master control through where you can take a decision and then control all the remote locations wherever you have, right? So that's the one example. So once we have this kind of a distribution geographically at a different location, we need a communication. So that is the most important part in the SCADA. So for SCADA, and then it all depends how much latency you have, how much time availability you have, how much refresh rate you want to have for a particular variable. Those are the crucial parameters. Whenever you implement SCADA, those are the critical parameters. You should know that. If my pressure is changing so fast, then I need to have a fiber optics link to get that data. Fine. If I have to get the information about power consumption every 1 second, I should have that kind of a link. I cannot rely on 3G. I cannot afford any downlink in between. So that's the point, how much reliability you want on the communication, and then accordingly the cost will also change, right? So that's how this SCADA one. So some of the applications I have shown. So pipeline monitoring. So once a gas pipeline, now PNG gas pipelines are everywhere in the Delhi at least. So you have a natural gas delivered through pipelines. I want to monitor the pressure at different locations. So as a Indraprastha Gas Limited, I should know where the pressure is getting down, how much is the pumping pressure I have to increase, and so forth. So I want to monitor centrally the complete distribution of the gas. Even the consumption rate also, I should know that. So same thing holds true with the electricity distribution as well. So this is one example where you can monitor the, this is a oil pipeline, but it can be anything. I'm just giving an example here. So you can just tap the pipeline, put a sensor there, connect with a PLC, have a communication installed there, and then this is one system ready, one location, and then it will be communicating back at the master station. Fine. So factory also, this can be done at a center. So many times I have seen that at shop floor there are many CNC machines, and sitting in a CAD room I can upload a, I can download a program to execute in a particular CNC machine. That is also a kind of a SCADA. Fine. So on A, B, C, D different machine, I can download a different part program sitting in a CAD room and then make the machine operate that. Fine. So that's all options available over here. This is a good example of a monitoring and pump the water supply for a city or a small town. So this is again, you have a different automation hardware at a different locations. Communication is very important in this case because we want to gather that information, and then monitoring is fine. If you want to put a control, then this latency is very important. If I pressed a button over here and then after 15 seconds if that breaker will trip up, then doesn't make sense to me. I want an immediate trip of that breaker if something goes wrong. So those kind of, so those communication part plays an important role over here. Fine? Yeah. Yeah.
Sir, in this case you are showing the RF radio model.
Mm-hmm. So radio frequency. So
for local application.
No, local it's not local. It's a different. So there's a collector well over here. If you see here, so in a pumping station you have a different kind of a system. Booster stations are there, reservoir is there, water plant is there, collector wells are there. So they are not at the same location.
No, suppose for this campus. Radio frequency, this device will work?
It will work everywhere, but the cost of affording that, whether you want that or not. See, and the reliability part. Wireless is the least reliable thing. If you want to have anything reliable, we always prefer to have high speed network on a fiber. That is the most reliable part nowadays, and fast and reliable, basically. Otherwise, wired communication is always reliable. People rarely rely on a wireless for the SCADA. Only the remote location where it is not feasible, then you can prefer a wireless link through a satellite. That is one thing that is not going to break so easily. Otherwise, if some other operator is running your services, then you are at his stake. You cannot do that.
Water supply.
Mm-hmm.
Can we have this local, some tower is there, like you have shown, in the campus, and then it can monitor all the pump and water supply?
Why not? We can have that. So we can always do that. There is no issue in that.
We have problems of permissions. Correct.
The range of wireless communication, the frequency band you want to use it. So all those things, I think what he is pointing out.
Interference. Mm. So you have to be very careful.
I just want to add something.
Mm-hmm. See, this SCADA
is determined really by the roles different people are expected to make in an enterprise.
Correct.
And therefore, you know, there's no definite answer that in this application
this particular communication works. Yeah, that's right.
You have to decide that if there is a leakage, let's say in a pipeline, or you're taking gas from a well, you can have all the fast acting devices with the PLC or a remote unit right there at the well itself. Then you have to determine what is the data which I need at the central thing, and maybe it's all right to have the data after 5 seconds or 10 seconds. So even a GSM input can be good enough.
Correct. So these are the points or the parameters, I should say, to select a SCADA system components from a selection of a right sensor to a right PLC to a right communication technology. So these are all basically, and everything depends on the kind of application you want to use it. Right? So to select a SCADA system components, choose a telemetry network. That's the first thing. So I started with the communication only. So telemetry network, on which network you want to operate the data, you want to move the data. So that is the first thing. Again, in all those parameters what Anupji has mentioned, and I keep on pointing out, the time delay, the reliability of the service, everything matters. And so the depending on your application, if it is not critical, even 5 seconds is good enough, even 15 seconds is good enough, even on Diwali and Holi, it's 1 hour is good enough, I can rely on SMS. So you understand that, what I just want to make. Normal operation time, you will get an SMS immediately. When there is a huge traffic, you will get an SMS after 15 minutes, sometimes in after 1 hour. Fine, so that's a problem. If you can afford the information at that rate, SMS can be used, no problem in that. but it's up to your system what you can afford it. Right? So how fast you want that information. Fine.
So what are the different telemetry network options?
I just keep discussing. See, all those communication is basically radio frequency, GSM, fiber optics, satellite, VSAT, all are these telemetry options.
Sir, what option which for that we need not to rely on another system? Means for the IIT campus, I don't want to rely on
satellite. IIT, I will prefer Ethernet. And nowadays we have a fiber optics also. So I will prefer that. See, whichever is easily available, if I want to gather some data of my home sitting in my office, I will prefer Ethernet. So wired link is already there, why to put a wireless there? So those kind of selections, yeah.
So Ethernet is also.
So those kind of options. See, if you have to lay something as a fresh, then you can decide. If something is already existing, better you can use it if it is affordable. Got the point?
Which is the cheapest option, sir?
Cheapest GSM.
And we don't need to rely on satellite on
all. That's what I'm saying. Cheapest is 3G. You use it if you can afford it. 3G is the cheapest option. Nowadays, all power distribution companies are using for remote data, getting remote data from the energy meters. All are based on GSM. Because for them, getting a data once in an hour is good enough. Because meter is locally storing data. So meter is almost kind of an PLC sitting there at your house or industrial premises. It keep on logging data, storing data. Once in a day or once in an hour, depending on frequency, whatever you want, it can dump the data to the server. So that can be done easily on 3G. There's nothing critical. But if I have to operate a substation, and if I want to control that substation sitting in one central location, then I need a reliable network. Then I cannot rely on 3G. Fine. So then you need so all substations mostly connected with the fiber optics only. Rarely at the remote location they can explore the VSAT. Otherwise, normally it's a wired network.
Okay. See, it's again a function of your what tasks you want to do. Suppose you also want to get video images. There is a fault you want to see.
Correct.
An explosion.
Correct.
On a tank has burst. Then obviously GSM will not give you video images.
And this is very challenging and upcoming things coming whenever you see Modi government is announcing smart cities. This is something that is required. See, this is one part of a smart city. If you want to have an implementation of smart city concept, you need to have this kind of an data flow and information flow within the city. If I want to know the traffic situations, if I want to know the power situations, if I want to know the water situation, if I want to control them, I think he is the right man who can give more information on that. But see, something a small scale we are discussing, and I have planned a visit, industry visit. I am taking half of the team to a power distribution SCADA. So then whatever I keep discussing today, you can even correlate there, how they are controlling the power distribution through their SCADA. Right? So that's what I think. I have made enough statements over here. Let me just take you to an example, because this is basic. So these are some of the options what he is asking. I'm not going to discuss in detail. So telemetry, network, topology, transmission mode, link, protocol, whatever. So all these things will come into picture whenever you want to decide on that. Same way in the equipments. In terms of PLC also, you have to choose the right IOs and the communication protocols, everything. So that's all here. I will just take you to this implementation example, because I have spoken so many things. So all are virtual. This can be done. This can be done. I can make a rocket. I can make a aircraft. Anything. But let me give you an example how exactly it can be done, and that's how we have done in the lab. So that's a simple example of visualization implementation. So next half an hour, I will just discuss on these slides how you can do that. So once you understand the PLC programming now, because that you have learned yesterday. So once you know those basic PLC programming, once you downloaded your program into the PLC, how can you have a visualization? How can you implement the visualization? So that I will give you an example. In this case, I am discussing not a machine level HMI, but the same concept can be followed for the machine level HMI as well. What we are discussing, we have implemented a kind of a standalone system which will be acting as a server and a client. Fine. So we have developed an application that will be acting as a client for an operator. So I have to make an operator interface, and then this operator interface, with the help of a server in between, is communicating with my hardware. And that's a three level that we have done. So I will just take you through two different options available for doing this kind of an implementation. First is basically some kind of a software provided by the manufacturer of HMIs or PLC manufacturer. So this is one example I am just showing you using a software factory talk view studio from Rockwell Automation. You can use any, but I'm not again confined to this, but the procedure almost remains same. So in this case, you can use this software interface to design user interface. Fine. So those who are not familiar with designing user interface, they are not very much familiar with Visual C++, Visual Basic or Visual C Sharp or some kind of a programming language in which they can design a user interface. Then they can use this kind of an application softwares provided by the PLC manufacturers, sometimes with the provided by the HMI manufacturer also. They are also providing a software to design the screen. So when I say HMI, it's basically designing of a, it's something you have to draw in a paintbrush. You have to make some boxes around. You have to make a indicator light. You have to make a push button. You have to make a graph, whatever you want to make it. Fine, sir. So it's as simple. You have to just draw some kind of a user interface in this software. So this software is Factory Talk View Studio. I will again discuss how this can be done without this software. So that part also I will discuss. So this software allows people to create and design application window in a single design environment. You can edit and reuse if you have created some kind of an HMI control for the previous application. You can reuse them again in this kind of thing. So steps involved in implementing this SCADA or HMI. These are the steps. First thing, you have to write program logic. That is the first thing. Hardware should be there. Then you have to write a PLC logic completely in whatever PLC you want to implement your controls. So development of logic diagram in RS Logic 5000, because here we are using a different PLC, so we will be using a, because you have used RS Logic 500 in the lab yesterday. Then if you have recall that modular PLC is basically a compact logics PLC, and we normally program that PLC using RS Logic 5000 software. So you have to build a ladder logic. The first starting point is that you have to build a control logic. You have to develop that logic and put inside the PLC. That's the starting point. Because what we are trying to do, we are creating an interface for that. Logic is always there. That's the starting step. So once you have done that, then you have to design a user interface. So whatever available graphics in this software. So you just explore that. All those buttons, indicators, window, all kind of windows control. If you see the progress bar, if you want to use a slider, if you want to use a knob to rotate. So all those kind of controls are there nowadays, because Windows give you that flexibility. So same kind of controls are there in this software also. So from there, you will be just dragging those controls and putting on the screen. That's a simple user interface design part. Then once you prepare this client by putting all those user controls on the screen, then now PLC program is there. You designed a screen. There need to be something in between. What it should be? Server. So client application I have designed. Then I have a hardware on the other end. I need a server. Even if it is on a standalone system, I need to put a server in between. Again, not server hardware. It's a server application that we need. Fine. So then this RS Links is basically one server that is coming with Rockwell Automation softwares. But you can use any server. And that is what we keep on saying, OPC server. That's an industry standard evolved open platform for communication. Fine. So OPC server is basically used for industry-wide communication. So once we are talking about communication hardware, communication link, but then it's fine. I have a mobile phone. You have a mobile phone, but I don't know Telugu. How can I talk to you? No, I know Hindi. You know Telugu. I need to understand your protocol. I need to understand your language. Then only I can exchange my information with you. So communication link is fine. I have a communication link, wireless link established. But the system, those are communicating on this link, they should understand each other's protocol. So that's the reason that industry developed a common platform, that is OPC. And OPC servers are openly available, even they are freely available. I would just like to show you the website of OPC Foundation, and you will get some information from there also. This is the site for OPC. I just run this video for you. Can you just see this? So you get a brief idea what OPC is.
What is OPC? OPC UA is an open standard that specifies information exchange for industrial communication. particularly on devices within machines, between machines.
I will show you brief. So see, because Siemens is also making their own PLCs, as we keep on discussing how we can make this interoperable. Interoperable means it should not be proprietary. If I develop my PLC, I will limit the user to use it only for develop the application. No, that should not be the constraint. So there should be agreement among the manufacturers. They should agree upon a common communication protocol.
What is OPC? OPC UA is an open standard that specifies information exchange for industrial communication, particularly on devices within machines, between machines, and from machines to systems in a convergence of IT and OT. It can be used with any software platform, Windows, Linux, Mac, Android, well, you get the picture. And this makes OPC UA scalable, from minimal embedded controllers to massive cloud infrastructures, even mobile devices. OPC UA is equally suited in a closed network or utilized via the internet. Don't worry though, security is baked into the protocol for access control, authentication, and encryption. Because of its flexibility, OPC UA has been widely adopted in industries like automotive, food and beverage, oil and gas, energy and utilities, packaging, building automation, and so on. So, as manufacturing moves into the industrial Internet of Things, Industry 4.0 realm,
so these are the features if you see it.
Is already poised to fulfill the requirements.
Just a 1 minute introduction about OPC. You can find out more details on opcfoundation.org. We'll get all the details over there. So what I'm just trying to emphasize over here, we are not going to discuss anything proprietary. You have a flexibility now. This OPC server, sometimes because we have Rockwell software, so they provide this OPC server. It comes along with it. So whenever you have a development environment for a particular PLC, they provide that OPC server. So same way you can have an OPC server in Automation Studio also. Yesterday what he was discussing, you can have an OPC server from Siemens also. The good part is that once you have an OPC server, then the communication protocol is fixed. So all those are exchanging information is same. They are talking about the same language. So that interface is required. So this RS Links is basically a OPC server for Rockwell Automation or Allen Bradley PLCs. Then once we have this server in between, I have developed a client application and I have a PLC hardware at the back. Fine. Now how this information will flow, what exactly you want to exchange. Fine. So that is basically known as tag. So tags are basically a name for the variables. Normally we have a variable and then we can define that variable with a name that we call them tag. In all SCADA development, you will come across this term. Tag. So you have to import the tag. So your OPC server should understand that tag. Now I have created some buttons and then indicators, but those are simple images. Unless I connect them with the PLC status. Fine. Suppose if I have created a lamp, and if I want to update it, if I want to change the state of that lamp from red to green or green to red, from 0 to 1, then this should not remain as a static image. It should be dynamic. It should be dynamic and the state should change. Now again, not based on some program that I am writing, it should change with respect to the variable or with respect to the input that is changing at the PLC. So then this OPC server is there. These tags should be the name given to this. So this OPC server understand the name given to this symbol that we have drawn in the user interface, and then we'll connect the same tag with a variable that is i0.0.1, whatever input you have defined there. So I can connect this graphical symbol with an input element inside the PLC through OPC server. That's a way, and that is how it can do that. You can import the tags, so tags basically the variable, connect them together. So now your user interface, whatever you have designed as a static image, now it will be a dynamic system which will get change, it will keep updating with respect to the variables that are coming from the PLC. So then I have created an user interface for that automated system. So I'm just going to explain individual steps. So let me just take you through this. So this is what the ladder logic, first thing I have to do, I have to create a ladder logic. This is one example that I'm showing over here for a motion control. So we have done for this. So I just want to demonstrate the single axis motion control. So what I will do, I will just write down the ladder logic. I will use the motion blocks in this ladder program. I will make that. But instead of address now, you can see here, I have given a names here. So address are now mapped onto the tag names. So tag names, now every time you cannot remember I colon 0 dot 0 slash 0, what it is. I can remember this as start of a motor. So you just give the user-friendly names that you can recall, and that we call them tags. So everywhere, wherever we have a variables in these blocks, as well as those input and outputs, we give them a name. And then these names are basically used as a tag whenever we import the tags in a RS links. Fine. Then you can design. So now you have all those options over here. This is a graphic designer window where you can drag and drop those controls here. So same way those who have designed some kind of a user interface in Windows, they may be familiar with that. So you can drop text box, you can drop a list, you can drop a button, you can have a some kind of an input text box also. So those controls can be dropped, those pictures or those boxes can be dropped from a user interface. And combining those interface, you can design. So for example, I am showing over here how a push button can be created. So you can have option over here. So there are a lot of options here. You can just click it and drag it. You will be designing that. Put a name over here and so on. So I have created a push button like this. So that way you will be designing all your controls or all your user interface components on this screen. So once you have done that, then you have to import the text and assign, because as I keep on mentioning that these pictures are not live, these are static pictures, but I have to connect them. So I have to basically assign PLC variables to this, then only I can make them change. So for that, importing of tags and assignment to various buttons, that is what you have to do. So OPC server RS links is used to facilitate the communication between this interface and your RS Logix 5000. That's a PLC program or PLC program development software and your user interface design software. Once you have done that, then so tags are defined. Then whenever you have this PLC connected, you will see all those tag variables names coming in this itself. So it's a tag browser. You just open it. All those variables that you have defined in your PLC ladder, they are now available over here. And then you can connect them to individual objects that you have created for user interface. Right? So this way, we have designed this user interface. So if you see that, we can make this user interface for one axis control, that is the x-axis. Now all those variables, those are required to execute that ladder. I pulled out those variables and put on this user interface. So if I have to run the motor at 500 RPM, so I will be accordingly giving that input to the motion block inside the ladder logic. Right? So whenever I make a selection over here, that selection will then communicate it as a variable value to the PLC program, PLC ladder, fine. That way you have an options here to select, then you have a push buttons start and stop. So whenever I will press this start, my XIC will get closed there. So now in the ladder logic, this is now get connected with that. So once I press start by a mouse or touch screen, this information will pass on to the PLC ladder. That this, so now it's not physical input coming in, it's input coming from the user interface, right? So then it will make the start and stop. So once you design this user interface, you can link it with the PLC and it will work. So we have done this for one example I will just show you. This is the one machine controller design that we have done for a Siemens PLC and a different touch panel. So this kind of an hardware you can have, so Siemens PLC connected with the input output devices. We developed this screen. So now you see that this is the screen that we have built. So this is basically the user interface that we have created here. And then we downloaded this user interface into that screen. And then it's linked with the functionality of that PLC. Fine. So once you have, so this is basically the screen in the software, the user interface design software. And now I will show the same screen. So this is one screen that we have designed. This is another screen that we have designed. So this is a designed screen. This is not the actual screen. The third one, that screen we have designed. And finally, if you see, the same screen is now appearing on that display. This is a picture of a display. So whatever screen you will design, you can just download into the HMI, you will see the same screen over there. And then this is another screen for a, so same screen whatever I have designed in a user interface software, same screen can be transferred to the HMI. So you will get the same interface. So you, so all these three, these are the pictures for that. And then you have linked all these controls which you have placed over here. So all sort of controls, if you see, the indicators are there, the push buttons are also there, slider is also there. So then it's get linked with the variables inside the PLC. So if I do any manipulation, this is a touch screen. So there's a pen over there, you touch it, and the same information get communicated to the PLC to execute the program. That's how the whole connection has been made. So this is working. So I have just explained how I have designed a user interface using factory talk view. There's another way of doing this is also you can use any Microsoft development environment. So Visual C Sharp can be used. So we have designed. Now rest of the steps will remain same. Only thing is that I am not using factory talk view this time. I want more flexibility. See, now what flexibility I will get? I can have an earlier what we have done, we have just pulled down some of the controls placed on the user interface. And then I have connected them with the PLC. That's all. But in between, if I want to execute some algorithm on my own, suppose after this input, I don't want to give an immediate command to the PLC, I want to execute something in between, then I need some kind of a programming language also. Fine. So then in this case, what that flexibility you will get. What we will do, we will design a user interface as we design a normal Windows program. So then you can design all those buttons. Then you link that program with a C sharp or C++ or C program. Then this C program is then controlling your PLC, fine. So all those tags now get controlled through the C++ or C sharp program. So that is the additional functionality you will be getting. Then you have an additional control on your application. So your input is not just enough. You want to process that information and then want to give a command to the PLC. Very clear example for this machine itself, because we don't want to run a CNC machine with the user interface I have shown to you. It's a one access control, just an application. How CNC machine operates? What exactly input you supposed to give it to the CNC machine? G and M codes, part program. So now part program is given by the user. Now if I just put that part program into this kind of an application and ask PLC to understand it, can it do that? No, not possible. PLC can only understand the input that are coming in its motion blocks. And then based on that, it will be just running the motors or the access, particular access. Now there is a requirement of a program which will understand this part program. Whatever a user is giving as an input, the program should understand that. If I write G01, it should understand it's a linear interpolation move with certain speed or certain RPM has to be controlled for the motor. Who will do this job? Neither PLC is doing this job, neither your user interface program that factory talk view is going to do that. That is your program, your job as a programmer, you have to do that. So what I will design a user interface same way. So now I have an option to just browse a file and then get that file in the program. Once that file is there, then I have to interpret this instructions. So individual line, I have to write a program or a software to interpret this line. Then from there, I have to extract the information which axis to move and how much. So after x equal to x, suppose 10, y, some coordinates is there, and if I have given G01. So these three variables, then I have to understand. So I have to write a program which will understand this language. So one program should understand the language of a part program, and then it can give an instruction to the PLC. So you need that kind of a program. So for that, this C# kind of an interface is much better. So again, if you see the steps, first initial steps remain same. You have to develop a ladder logic that is always required. So same ladder program I have to put in the PLC, which will be controlling my individual axis of the motor. Then user interface, now I am designing in a Visual Studio. I am not using the factory talk view that has been provided by the Rockwell. Now I am using a normal Microsoft Visual Studio, whatever version I can have. So Visual Basic, you can just use that also. So in that case, I am designing the, now you have a more flexibility of a very fancy controls. Even if you see a Visual Studio 2013, you will get more and more controls now coming up. So then you can use all sort of controls that are available for a Visual Studio normal Windows application development environment. And then you connect. Now OPC server is still there. So now what we have done, we have developed an application which will be taking a user input and then interpreting that information and then communicating to PLC through OPC server. Right? So that part has been done in this case. In fact, along with that, we need to have some kind of an input-output controls also. So we would like to provide those buttons also. If I want to make a stirrer on, if I want to make an electromagnet on, how much current I have to give into electromagnet. So all those inputs I can create in this case. And then I will put all them together in a ladder logic. So this is a ladder program that I have to do. After you downloaded this ladder logic into the PLC, then this is a RS links interface that you will get. Now I want to connect it basically. So RS links will provide an OPC connection. So you will just select your PLC here. Then you will selecting an OPC server. So if your system have multiple OPC server, you just select which one you want to use, because in our system we were having a Festo OPC server also. So RS links we have selected over there. As soon as you select it, all PLC variables will now be available here. You can see all those variables which you have used in a ladder logic. Now I want to connect these variables individually with my user interface or the program that I have written. So I want to call, suppose if I want to set a speed. So speed, this PLC will understand one parameter here which will define the speed. What I will do, I will call a statement in my Visual C Sharp program and I will set that variable it to 100 or 500 whatever. And so that as soon as you assign that value to the variable, it will get communicated to the PLC through this OPC server. That's how it get communicated. So this is how we have written. I'm just going to give you a glimpse. So now this is almost a C Sharp program here. We have called some instructions to connect with the OPC server here. So you have just written a server.url and then server.connect, so it get connected with. So my application is now get connected with the OPC server. And then I can pass on the variable values using a simple variable assignments. So if I have to check whether motor is enabled or not, then case you put the variable name. This variable name you are getting from the OPC server, the tag names that you have given in the program. And that way, you have a simple high-level language communicating with the PLC. So now you have designed a user interface, you have built your own logic in between, then you have communicated with the hardware. So once you are able to do this complete cycle, you can design any user interface for your system. So that's the two. So we have done this for the part program itself, because we want to develop a CNC controller using PLC. We want to have that. Though there are dedicated CNC controllers are there, we want to do experiment because that gives you more flexibility. So we want to parse all these instructions, so G00, G0, so whenever. So we need to have a program that will read this. So we designed this basic interface. So this is a part program you just put into this. And then it will interpret each and every line. Then based on that, it will be extracting the information and then picking up the coordinates, x40, y0, and so forth. And then accordingly passing the values of variables to the PLC to execute the motion in the servo motor. So that's how it get connected. So from a user interface to the finally backend hardware, how it all get connected and working. So that's a simple example and glimpse I have given you. That's all for today's lecture. That's enough. Thank you very much. And if you have any query, so from a basic end, I have shown you how we have done it, how we have executed it. So that's the most important part. Automation, I keep on saying, just listening is not enough. The first thing that I started with, you have to do some kind of an implementation. And once you are able to do this kind of a simple implementation, I'm sure you can do any kind of a programming for the PLCs and then HMIs. So that's all about the visualization today.